Tonight on Our Century, our love affair with the car.
A good deal of the country over which one travels has no roads at all. Jump in
my car. When the automobile arrived in Australia, well, we just couldn't wait to climb aboard. Come on, jump in my car. And that car has travelled a lot of kilometres over the last 100 years. And it's left its track all over our country and all over our character. If nothing else, we're a fairly practical mob. If something's essential to life and we don't have it, well, then we just invent it. A bit like the ute. This is a 1951 Holden ute, original colour too, and it goes right back in a long line to about 1932. The story goes that a Victorian farmer said he needed a car to take his missus to church on a Sunday and the pigs to market on a Monday. No easy call. But a man named Lou Brandt, who worked for the Ford Motor Company in Geelong, came up with the answer. He designed a completely new car. It had a comfortable cabin here and a buckboard back there. He called it his coupe utility. Now, the Aussie ute was much loved by the Aussie farmers. In fact, it was copied by car manufacturers right around the world.
Australia, what's your favourite sport? Snack?
Pie.
Animal?
Kangaroo.
And what's your favourite car, Australia?
Holden.
Let me see, that's football, meat pies, kangaroos and Holden cars, huh?
Right.
Well, you sure sound like Australia to me.
We are.
Well, then you better tell me again, because I just might forget.
We love football, meat pies, kangaroos and Holden cars.
If you were to believe the spin doctors of the 1970s, Australians favoured the homegrown product.
Kangaroos and Holden cars.
We liked Aussie sport, Aussie food, Aussie animals, and especially locally made cars. This television ad for Holden cars became a bit of an anthem back then, and it said a lot about our love affair with the car. But was this Holden really Australian? We'll come back to that later. Whatever its true origins, for most of our century, the car has been one of those must-haves for Australians, and we've been keen to give it a national identity.
This is Australia, island continent of wide horizons and vast distances. 500,000 miles of roads, capital cities lie hundreds of miles apart. The horse and buggy days are in the limbo of forgotten things. 50 years ago, the horseless carriage made its alarming appearance.
When the horseless carriage arrived in the 1890s, it was seen as an expensive craze that would soon pass. Besides, Australia could breed its own horses and grow their feed. But the car and the petrol both had to be imported. The dream of the great Aussie car started with this, a steam-powered buggy built by a Victorian named Herbert Thompson. That was 4 years before the start of the century. Thompson drove his buggy from Bathurst to Melbourne in 1900, averaging 8 miles an hour. That was pretty good considering the rugged route that he had to travel. He went on to build and sell 10 locally made vehicles. But by then, the mass-produced and cheaper American petrol-powered cars had crossed the Pacific. Like every other toy since then, Australians took to the car. But could these devils from Detroit handle Australia's vast distances and the bush tracks? Well, all that was about to be tested with the first Dunlop reliability trial from Sydney to Melbourne in 1905. Like the great sporting nuts that we are, 60,000 spectators flocked to see the start. 23 state-of-the-art vehicles testing their stuff against the worst the Australian outback could throw at them. There were no tarred roads, just rutted dirt tracks. And one car reported 13 punctures on the first day. Through rivers and rugged bush they rolled, running out of spares and refueling out of stone jars. The marathon journey took 5 days, with 15 cars finishing the race at an average of, wait for it, 26 miles an hour. Still, it did the job, proving that the jalopy was the way to go. By World War I, an Adelaide saddler named James Alexander Holden had started making motor body parts. He was in the right place at the right time, when the American giant General Motors started assembling cars in Australia in the mid-1920s. Using Holden's locally made bodies, the General set up factories, and by 1931 merged with the local company to form General Motors Holden. By 1934, GMH was producing 84 different models of car. Australians in the middle of the Depression were the proud owners of more than 600,000 registered motor vehicles. And that's one car for every 11 people. And while those early Rattlers were basic in design, they were built to last. Take Black Beth, a 1927 standard. She was bought new by Norman Chappell from Roseville in Sydney. Norman borrowed £325 for Black Beth, so he could visit his fiancée Agnes, who lived in Gundagai. And young Norman's 500-mile trek across dirt roads each weekend paid off when they married and produced a son, Bill. And Bill kept up the family tradition when he courted, married and honeymooned his wife, Rosemary, in the same car 25 years later. Part of the family for three generations now, Black Beth has taken six chapel brides to the altar, carried home 11 grandchildren from hospital, and undergone three colour changes. Having clocked up 250,000 miles, the old girl is still going strong and has never been to a garage. She's been lovingly cared for by Bill and his dad, who are the only men to have ever peeped under her bonnet. Although the Depression had sent many industries to the wall, the motor business continued to thrive. By the 40s, the car was everywhere, and even the kids got in on the act. The Soapbox Derby became a local event in towns across the country. All you needed were a couple of wheels, an old wooden crate, and some rope. Oh, and usually a good steep hill. Many an Aussie kid felt the tar in his kneecap or smiled a toothless grin after finding out that the billy cart didn't come with brakes. In the grown-up world, the thing that did slow down big cars was the impact of World War II. Local manufacturers were pressed into war service and petrol was rationed. But the war was not all bad news. It made us at least more self-reliant. We discovered that we were capable of manufacturing on a grand scale. Ben Chifley was given the job of crank-starting Australia once again, so he issued a challenge to the motor industry. GMH started work on what was to be the great Aussie car. The fact that it was actually designed in Detroit, well, who cares?
Then from the United States comes the first full-scale model, the prototype, handmade for complete road testing under Australian conditions.
2 years of testing the new car in tough Australian conditions, and the first Holden was born. They called it the 48215. GMH started by building just 10 Holdens a day.
Australia's Prime Minister, Mr. Chifley, is one of the first to inspect the completed model.
But we all fell for this new car in a big way. It had everything going for it. Powerful enough for Australian conditions, yet ideal for the Australian family. In no time flat, there were 250,000 new Holdens in our driveways. It took the Ford Motor Company another decade to introduce its first Australian-made car, the Falcon. And that kicked off the great argument. Which was better, the Ford or the Holden? Thank you.
throughout the 50s and 60s, the number of new cars outstripped new people. And with the cars came the culture. Australia was on the move.
After lunch on Sunday, many go out for a drive. It's something of an institution, because there's about one car for every six people.
The car boot became a sort of second home. The Aussie holiday was now taken in caravan parks. And motorists suddenly discovered purpose-built hotels that became, of course, the motel.
Will you just be quiet? You're upsetting your father.
And the long family car trips meant that we had to invent new games to save the frazzled nerves of Mum and Dad.
I spy with my little eye something beginning with M.
Mum!
No, it's outside the car. Hurry up.
Mailbox.
Right, you both win.
And there were other games in the car too. Those with teenagers now had to cope with the drive-in theatres. The first one opened in Coburg, Victoria in June 1955. This was a family open-air cinema where you could take the car, watch a movie, and let the kids potter in the playgrounds. But there were other distractions.
No, I don't.
The landscape was to change forever. A new generation of car commuters arrived, and with them, the great urban sprawl. By now, the car was a means to an end, and it took us down many different paths. It even changed our eating habits.
Time for dinner.
Dad, stop the car.
And Hugo said, you go.
And I said, no, you go.
And soon he was back with the pack. And then Dad hit the track. So we ate in the back, feeling better inside.
With an empty tummy, thank goodness for Kentucky Fried.
Steps to teach it young. As luck would have it, we've chosen a bad day because they're all women drivers. Now here's a scene that proves women drivers are born, not made. You'll notice she stopped to let the pedestrians through. She wants to turn left, so what hand signal does she give? You're so right.
Now, it would be a brave or a foolish man who used that sort of commentary today. But for decades, the car was a very blokey thing. And women drivers were the butt of as many jokes as the mother-in-law. Many men saw the car as a means of escape. Car clubs sprung up, and with them one of the most ambitious sporting events anywhere in the world.
This is going to be fast, folks. We're out on the Red X route, and here are highlights of the tough country that lies ahead of competitors.
The first of the Red X car trials was held in 1953. It was an ambitious project, pitting drivers against corrugated bush tracks in a grueling 10,000-kilometre outback race. At the Sydney showground for the start, 50,000 spectators cheered on the daredevils, and another 150,000 people lined the streets out of Sydney. Among the legendary drivers who completed the Red X trials were gelignite Jack Murray and the colourful radio personality Jack Davey. Mindful of the movie-tone news camera, Davey curiously kept a can of hairspray in his car. In towns throughout Australia, people flocked to catch sight of these ordinary family cars thrashing their way through the bulldust.
The only roads in this part of Australia are stock routes. They're so rough that the cars give milkshakes.
Jack Brabham was the bloke next door who jumped in a car and drove to glory. Brabham became an international star when he won back-to-back Formula One Grand Prix in 1959 and in 1960. And then, just so we wouldn't forget his name, he went back and won another world title in 1966. Australia's wide-open roads and unrestricted speed laws were an open invitation for the rev heads to do a brabham, as they call it. Over the century, more Australians have died on our roads than in our wars.
The toll of road accidents in Australia is appalling, said the Archbishop. At least 80% of these accidents are preventable. And then, in sonorous Latin, His Grace pronounces His blessing on the cars and those who drive them.
Road safety campaigns started decades ago. The campaign changed, but the message remained the same.
Get the safety habit.
And we passed laws to help drivers protect themselves.
A man unable to use all the skill he possesses has no right to be at the wheel of a motor car.
In the cities, we've always had a speed limit. But the first blood alcohol limit was set in Victoria in 1966.
Alcohol is a major factor in the deaths of half the drivers killed on the roads in Australia every year.
By the mid-70s, we'd made seatbelts compulsory, and there were now open road speed limits as well. The highway carnage continued, but the percentage of casualties began to fall.
You'll get an extra thrust of power and rail brakes.
It's unreal, though. Unreal. I didn't expect to be this good.
You could slow the speed and you could ban the boots. But for some, the car was still the ultimate sex symbol.
Hey, Charger.
Come to the middle of nowhere to see a car.
Security.
Hmm?
A lot of people would like to get their grubby little paws on that car. P76 is a brand new car, and we are out here to test it in the worst possible Australian conditions. Watch this.
Now, a story about the cars just wouldn't be fair dinkum without mentioning the P76, the Australian car that left a lasting impression for all the wrong reasons. When the Leyland Car Company unveiled it in 1972, it was almost the second coming. But this was a case of the wrong car at the wrong time. The V8 engine guzzled fuel just as petrol prices soared. And while it may have looked the part with its 70s colour scheme, for Australians it came in only one colour, and that was lemon. Only 18,000 cars were made, and the P76 died 18 months after its immaculate conception. Over our century, the Australian car has had plenty of colour and costume changes. Come on, jump in my car. But there's always been a model to meet our needs. It's too far to walk on your own. Brisbane man Paul Ruckert filmed all of his cars and the family follies that came with them. The collection is a fantastic record of ordinary folk having fun with the automobile. Motoring madness, maybe, but it reminds us of the special place that the family sedan held in our hearts. Jump in my car. I wanna take you home. The old motor car has come a long way this century, considering that up until 1919, you got a driver's license from the dog inspector. Another funny thing, we started this century driving city cars in the bush, and now, fashion being what it is, we're driving bush trucks in the city. 50 years ago, or almost, this was the most popular farm machine. Nowadays, it's more like that. Still, our love affair with the car is a bit like this old beauty here. It looks like it could go on forever. Thank you.
Can I come too?
No, Sam. Oh, all right. Come on, get in.
Not here by the roadway. I've been driving hard all day. Dreaming of the old folks and the homestead all the way. Dreams I see the old place. I'll be there within a week. Where there's gum trees by the roadway and willows by the creek. Forever there'll be gum trees and willows by the creek.